Good afternoon. I am Judge Deborah Thomas, and I am so glad that you are tuning in with us today. Get your pencil and paper out. Now, every show, I tell you, get your pencil and paper out, because I do my best to bring you information that can be helpful. Let's start with my first expungement form. Well, I can't actually say that, but it'll be the second. But I have my expungement form coming up. It's going to be April 21. That's on a Saturday. April 21, an expungement form. And it's going to start at 1 o'clock. I'm going to leave the show and go straight to the location. The location is New St. Paul Church of God in Christ. Most of you know that that's on Finkel and the Southfield Service Drive. Near Grand River, most of you know where that's located. Now, I'll get the exact address and bring it to you as the date comes closer. But if you know someone who wants to get some information on how to expunge their criminal record, the next form that I have coming up is going to be Saturday, April 21. We're going to start at 1 o'clock, and that's at New St. Paul Church of God in Christ on Finkel and the Southfield Service Drive. I'll give you that information again before we close. I have a wonderful guest today. My guest today is Dr. Cherie Tanadar.
Yes.
How are you doing?
I'm very good, Judge. How are you?
I am wonderful. I had an opportunity to read your book, and I couldn't put it down.
Oh, wow.
When I started, I had some place to go, and I got frustrated and irritated because I had to put it down, go someplace. I came back. I have told people about the book. They wanted to borrow my copy, and I was afraid because I've done this before. I lend out my book, and I never get it back. The book is called The Blue Suitcase. I don't know if they can see it well, but The Blue Suitcase is the title of the book. And I'm going to recommend this book, The Blue Suitcase. I'm going to recommend it for, I would say, young people starting high school, especially. Mm-hmm. Moving through every age group. It's an easy read book. And I had someone today ask me, well, what does that mean? Easy read means that the words aren't so big you can't figure out what they're saying. And it flows easily. It keeps your attention. And the book is about your life story.
Yes, ma'am.
And what I really found so interesting about it is that there were so many experiences in your life that I could relate to and that people that I know relate to. Mm-hmm. Now, just for starters, and it's an inspirational book, because the bottom line is you are telling people that success is based primarily on determination, mm-hmm. and just not giving up.
Not giving up, absolutely.
Not giving up.
And I learned that from my mother.
You learned it well. Now, in your book, you have talked about several experiences.
Yes.
And I guess the one that maybe speaks loudest to me is that while you were a student, there came a time when you finally managed to get an apartment, mm-hmm. and you came home one day, and the lights and the gas were turned off.
That's right. You know, this was in Akron, Ohio, and I was a teaching assistant, and I was also working on my PhD in chemistry. And in the summer, 3 months in summer, there is no lab to teach, so I wouldn't get paid. So I only get paid for 9 months, and I got $300 per month. I would take $75 out of that, send it to home, so my family can put food on the table.
Yes.
And I would live in that $225. But then when summer comes, there is no money. So I came home and there is no electricity and I couldn't even keep the apartment. And I started sleeping in my car. I had bought a car for $200,
okay.
an Impala, and I would sleep in the car.
Homelessness.
Yes.
So you have, not only can you relate to people who are forced into situations. You did have a job, okay? You were on kind of like what we might call layoff.
Yes.
But sometimes you're doing your best, you're working your hardest, but the economics put you in a situation where you're sleeping in your car.
I'm sleeping in my car, and when it got too hot in the car, I had a key to the building, the chemistry building, because that's where I did my research. So I would then go and sleep in a seminar room because nobody would be there at nighttime, so I could just sleep there. And they had a shower because people that work in the with the animals, they had a shower. So I would just have a shower, and I was terrified with the mouse and everything, the animals in there. And then one day I was working very late on my chemistry project, and I couldn't sleep till 4 a.m. So I went to bed at 4 a.m., couldn't get up at 7:30 like I always did. And at 8 o'clock, walks in the dean and four professors because they were going to have a meeting there.
So you got busted.
I got busted. I was sleeping on my sleeping bag on the floor. So I thought I got in trouble. So I took my sleeping bag, went back to the car, and started sleeping in the car again. And 2 years later, that same dean gave me an award, Outstanding Teaching Assistant.
Yes.
And
yes.
When he gave me that award, he said, Shri is very hardworking. He works so hard, that many a nights he's known to sleep in the department.
See there? So sometimes you just have to persevere. Mm-hmm. Persevere. Also, I found fascinating was that there was a time when you could not afford car insurance, auto insurance. And I know many of our viewers often complain about the high cost of auto insurance. And it was announced this week that the auto insurance, no-fault portion of it, is going to go up over $100 a car.
Yes.
And that the group that's raising this rate, they don't have to show anybody any records in terms of the billions, with a B, of dollars that are sitting in a pool.
It's a scam. MCCA, that's the group. And they have, understandably, billions of dollars. And they're raising rates again on Michiganders. You know, Michigan pays the highest auto insurance in the country because of our no-fault insurance.
Yeah.
And furthermore, you know, what I want to do is I want to stop the insurance company from using non-driving factors in figuring out auto insurance. For example, it should not matter where you live, the zip code you live, or what your education level is.
Okay.
It really should not matter, nor should it matter, you know, what your credit score is. What does that have to do with auto insurance? You know, what I saw is that a man living in Bloomfield Hills with two DUIs has the same insurance rate as a person with a perfect driving record living in Detroit, Michigan. Now, that's not fair.
That is not fair. That is, and you know, and it also fascinates me that you use the concept and you understand the concept of what is fair.
Yes.
And that is oftentimes a driving force in your decisions. What is fair?
Yeah.
Now, also in the book, and people, I think that this is a good book, especially for young people, because some of these life experiences people don't anticipate, but they happen not just to you.
Yeah.
But to a lot of folks. Now, you were trying to get an education so that you could improve your life and the life of your family. And you had an employer who stood in your way.
That's right.
And it wasn't like you were trying to leave the job.
No.
And I have run into a young man recently who actually got fired from his job because his employer found out he was going to school.
Yes.
After 2 years and no issues on the job.
Exactly.
And this young man was just, could not understand why someone would stop a person from trying to improve themselves.
Exactly. You know, when I was 14 years old, my father was forced to retire. No retirement benefits. And, you know, four sisters, me and my brother. So the family fell into poverty. And I worked as a janitor when I was 14 years old. And I worked throughout my high school and throughout my college, I took jobs to help my family. Now, education was the ladder for my success. That ladder is broken for too many Michiganders today. Education has become so expensive,
Yes.
so I want to make the community college and the public universities tuition free. Well, there is money out there. One is we need to revamp our tax structure. If you look at the corporations and look at the ultra wealthy people, they don't pay their fair share of taxes. Secondly, we are giving away hundreds of millions of dollars to big corporations to come and set up a shop here.
Okay.
When we give them the money, they come and set up a shop. Our politicians get a photo op. Later on, they close the shop. No one knows about it. So the net gain of jobs as a result of these corporate giveaways has essentially been zero.
And I do know some young people who have had to stop school because they ran out of financial aid.
Exactly. And education, in my mind, is not a privilege. And health care is not a privilege.
Now that's another one. How you gonna pay for a single payer? These are some very expensive propositions.
It is in the, but in the long run, they're going to save money. I tell you why. Because currently, United States spends what, trillions of dollars on health care. Now, 20% of that cut goes to the insurance companies. When we have a single payer health care, we don't need these insurance companies. Secondly, the pharmaceutical companies are charging us an arm and a leg. If you notice, the pricing for prescription medicine in the United States is the highest among the whole world.
Yeah, the free world, though. Yeah,
Our cost of health care is the highest. And you would say, if our cost is highest, our care must be the
the
highest.
best in
Best, and it's
the
not the case, though. We are seventh in the world in terms of quality of health care, but the first in the world for cost. And tell you why. And that's because the insurance companies are making a ton of profit, and the pharmaceutical companies are making a ton of profit. And when we bring single-payer health care, and I would like to see that happen at the national level, so that I would pressure our congressional delegation to work on that. But if for some reason it cannot be done at the national level, I want to do single-payer health care at the state level.
Now, I the name of the book is The Blue Suitcase,
Yes.
and you arrived in the United States with a total of $20 in your pocket and everything you owned in a blue suitcase.
Well, yeah. Actually, I had $16 because I had a couple beers on the plane.
Ah, okay.
But a big dream. I came here with a big dream. And the thing that I love about our country, the United States of America, is the opportunities and the freedom this country. We complain about our country, but at the same time, this is the best place
In the
in the
world.
whole world. There is nothing like America in the whole world. And I can tell you that because I've traveled and I've come from another country. So I appreciate America and what America has done for me, what Michigan has done for me. And that's why I sold my business 2 years ago so that I can devote full time to public service.
Well, you have a history of public service. In your book, you talk about that you volunteered and was hired in. I tell people all the time, you're looking for a job, go volunteer. They may keep you. With a crisis hotline,
Yes.
suicide prevention, and you are committed to mental health services?
Absolutely, absolutely. In 1982, when I first came to Michigan, I was working as a scientist. I'm a chemist.
Yeah.
So my degrees are a bachelor's, master's, and a PhD in chemistry. But I found a place that was helping young children who had run away from home. And I did some counseling. I counseled young children and their families and putting families together again. And I also manage a suicide prevention helpline.
Yes.
So I talk, you know, I would work there on weekends and on evening as a volunteer. Didn't get paid for it, but I worked on it to do that, to get, but in a few years later, you know, I got married. My children were 4 and 8 years old, and my first wife died.
Yeah.
And we didn't realize at the time, but she had severe depression. And, you know, I lost a family member to mental health, and I'm very aware what mental health can devastate a family.
Yes.
And, you know, since Governor Engler's time, we have seen the government of Michigan has cut mental health, closed down hospitals.
I see it at the courthouse all the time. People are there because of mental health issues, mm-hmm. and it's difficult to assist those people. We talk about rehabilitation, but the availability of programs.
Yes.
And then some people simply do need supervision. They need mm-hmm. a housing situation. So are you have experienced the hardship.
Yes. Yes.
And I really admire the fact that you were open
yes.
about it in your book.
Well, I have lived a life in a very transparent way, and I'm a very open person. Now, our state, Michigan, is the last in transparency and ethics if you compare with any other state. Our governor, our lieutenant governor, the lawmakers are not subject to freedom of information.
Ah.
And I want to change that. But I'm very transparent, and I wrote my story in this book just like how it happened. I just finished updating that book to current. So this book was published in 2008.
Okay.
I have my new book now that is current to 2017. And I talk about the good stuff that happened to me, the bad stuff that happened to me. I talk very honestly about the mistakes I made, you know, and the failures I have, because you can learn a lot from a person's failures.
Yeah, hopefully the person learns a lot.
A lot, yeah.
Now, what's going to be the name of the new book?
I haven't yet decided. I will probably figure it out next week.
Now, if someone wants to get a copy of the book.
Yes.
And as I said, I am a big supporter of education because I started off as a teacher. Mm-hmm. And in my community for generations, we were always taught that get an education. That's the one thing nobody can take from you.
True.
And that it allows for opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
Even in your life and in your life story, you talked about how you were just denied access. You were qualified. All you wanted was to get your foot in the door. And oftentimes, people are just not given the opportunity to show what they can do.
Absolutely.
And then you discuss that in your book. I think that's important as well.
Yeah, and you know, I learned that from my mother. And my mother never was allowed to complete her high school. But she was a very strong woman, a very smart woman. And when the family fell into poverty, I saw her take charge and try to help us. And I saw her, what I learned from her is how never to give up, no matter how hard things get.
Yes.
You know? And I tell you, one day, the family had nothing to eat. Everything in the kitchen was empty. And we haven't eaten for 24 hours. And what she did was she boiled a pot of water. She put a little bit of salt in it. And she found two fistful of rice powder that she put it into that, made a paste. And she fed the whole family. And that was our only meal in the 24 hours.
I'm telling you, folks, I think the book is inspirational. And it teaches a lot of important life lessons. People from your own community oftentimes were the ones who were holding you back. And I think that's a surprise to a lot of our young people.
Mm-hmm.
And then to sacrifice to persevere.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's part of what I found so fascinating about your life story. Now, for those of you who just tuned in, my guest today is Dr. Sheree Tanadar.
Yes.
And as you know, I don't endorse any candidates at all. Well, a couple of judges, maybe. But I do try to bring you information and bring people to you that you might like to know and to get more information about. And I met you at a community police precinct meeting.
That's right.
And you were very approachable. And once I read the book, I just had to let folks know about this book.
Yeah, and I sold my business in 2016.
Okay.
And I said, I'm going to run for governor. I was the fourth person to enter the Democratic primary for the next governor of Michigan. But lately, it looks like a two-person race. In the recent polls are showing,
I'm trying to get all the candidates to come out. Okay, you know, I try to bring folks information.
Yeah, we should. I think we should make an informed decision. Our primary is on August 7th.
Okay.
And there are good candidates on the Democratic side. And we must have a Democrat as the next governor of Michigan, because
I'm nonpartisan.
But because the one party that has controlled the Lansing government for the last 7 years has taken it too far to the right. And I think it's time that we make our government work for the people.
Now, where do people get a copy of the book? Now, I did convince you to leave a few copies here at the station. Mm-hmm. So, you know, first come, first serve.
Yes.
But if someone wants to read the book, if they want to give the book to their grandchild,
yeah,
someone that's in college, there was a time you couldn't afford the books.
Yes.
For the class.
You're right.
But you checked out books from the library on those topics.
Yes.
And you read those books instead. I know of a young man that quit college because he could not afford the books. Mm-hmm. I don't think it ever crossed his mind to go get books from the library. Mm. How can people get the book?
Well, every event that we have.
Yeah, but how do they know where you're going to be?
They can see on our website. We have events. They can also see my Facebook. My Facebook is very good, Sheree4MI, Sheree4MI is my Facebook, and they can see the next event. Every event we carry these books, we give these books a complimentary copy, so you don't have to pay for the book.
Okay.
You can also go to my website and download a book if you are computer savvy.
All right, what's that website address or whatever?
The website is www.sheree2018.com, sheree2018.com.
And you can download the book.
You can download the book free of cost. You know what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave maybe about 30 or so books at the front desk here at the radio station.
Yeah.
So if they want to come and pick up a copy, a complimentary copy, they can do so.
I think teachers, especially teachers for our high school, also there are a lot of programs for people who are reentry programs. There are programs for young people. And I think that it's important that they understand that some of the setbacks and some of the hardships, they're not the only one.
That's right. That's right.
They're not the only one who's experienced
it. And as a next governor of Michigan, I want to fix our education, because education was the ladder for my success. I want to make that education available to all of Michiganders.
All right, I've just got the signal. We've only got 2 minutes left. I'm going to take one phone call. You got to speak your question real quick. But before we do that, because I didn't get a chance to have callers come in, will you come back?
Oh, I'd love to come back. Just call me.
Okay.
I'd love to come back.
I'm going to take one quick call. Hello, caller.
Hello there, and happy Easter to everybody.
Happy
Thank
Easter.
Thank you for taking my call. Sheree, you got my vote. I will email you some concerns in the new week. I would like to know if you were going to pick like a vice or deputy governor, I think a good name that would be a great fit for you would be Verge Fenero. Because Verge, in the last time he ran against Snyder, would have really taken more votes, and he did pretty good, but he didn't quite have the money. I'm disappointed that Brian Kelly is running, considering the Flint crisis, and I say you need to turn the heat up on that.
I agree. Good point. And let me.
Nope, because we're running out of time. But you did promise you were going to come back.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, okay. You did promise you were going to come back. I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. I want to thank you for the book that you have written, and I think that it's quite inspirational. I have told several people about it, and they've already asked me for copies, and I told them they can't have my copy because people won't give you your book back. But there will be copies here at the station. I think that people should read it. The book stops, I think, in 08, did you say?
2008.
But, and you have been a Michigan resident again, because this wasn't your first time, but you've been a Michigan resident again since?
2010.
All right. And you went to University of Michigan.
That's right. Originally in 82, I was a scientist at the University of Michigan.
Well, I want to thank you for coming on. I want to thank you for sharing the information. I don't endorse candidates. I just bring you information. I hope that you found this program to be informative. And as always, I love you.